Let's start out with this discussion of the yield curve, because we talk about it a lot, the twos and tens, and how it really affects banks and whether it really discourages banks from lending. I'm going to put up a chart here that shows the blue line going up is commercial bank loans and leases, okay? You can see the green is going down. That's the twos and tens. How is it affecting your business?
Well, I think right now that the back end of the curve is probably suppressed a bit from where it should be naturally. So there's a number of factors, low global interest rates. There's some temporal issues around tensions in emerging markets, trade tariff tensions, U.S. political uncertainty that I think have the 10-year overbid. So I think you have to look at where is the loan demand in the economy, and if it's strong, you have to be there to support your customers and make loans. So we're seeing good demand on the commercial and industrial side, good demand in commercial real estate, and there's pockets in consumer where we're also seeing some nice activity.
Does it limit your ability to make money because you can't charge as much interest as you otherwise
might? Well, the good news is that most banks are asset sensitive and more exposed to the short end of the curve. So as the short rates are going up, our loans are repricing faster than deposits still. So the rise in short rates is beneficial to our net interest margin.
Still, but for how long? Because JP Morgan on the last call, they said that the competition with online banks, alternative lenders, all of that is going to start pushing up deposit beta.
Yeah, that's something to watch. And
are you noticing that?
Yes, your
bank?
Certainly. So the side of the market around commercial depositors or more affluent depositors in the wealth segment, they want to participate as rates are going up. They want to, if their loans or costs is going up, they want to get more on their deposits. The mass customer, the folks with lower balances in the branches, aren't as rate sensitive, and so banks are still holding the line there. So net-net, our betas are going up, but we can still see net interest margin expand.
It's a similar question when it comes to the non-traditional lenders that JP Morgan referenced, like Goldman Sachs and Marcus, for example. I mean, they have such low rates because they can. How does that not hurt you?
Well, they're playing in particular niches in the marketplace, and I'd say if you look at where they're raising deposits, they don't have bricks and mortar, so they're going through the digital channels, and that's a relatively more expensive channel to raise funds. So I think there's a limit as to how competitive at the end of the day they can be. The broader places where we have relationships, we've focused on niches like education refinance loans, so students are carrying a high level of debt. It's highly priced if it's a government loan, so once someone's out of school for 5 or 6 years, we can refinance that loan and save them money and bring a millennial customer to the bank. Okay. There's none of the fintechs really are playing there. SoFi is somebody that we've provided liquidity to, so really we and SoFi have really built up that market, and we've had $4 billion of originations over the last 3 years of those kind of loans. So you have to choose your spots. If you go into areas like personal unsecured, like Marcus is playing, it's more competitive. But if you're very focused, you can find attractive places to lend money and make good returns.
So you have a bricks and mortar operation, 1,200 branches, as I said, right? At the same time, you are moving into the online, the mobile banking.
Right.
That gives you the advantage of being able to compete worldwide, certainly nationwide, overnight. At the same time, it brings a lot of competitors against you. So when you talk about picking your spots, when it comes to that online, what is your spot? I mean, and how do you avoid just competing on price?
Sure. So, I think the business models are moving towards digital. So you have to have great online capabilities and great mobile capabilities, and that has to be seamlessly integrated with your physical branches. And I think we're doing a really good job at that. Customers have great experiences with other industries. It's simple, it's easy to use, it's intuitive. Those other companies use data really well, so we have to be as good at that as other industries. And I think banks have been playing a bit of catch-up. Mm. When we look at our digital channels, we've introduced some great new products. We have a robo-advisory product called Specify. We have a small business loan origination platform that we do with a fintech called Foundation. So we're really playing kind of forward-leaning, on the front foot, embracing the new digital approaches.
What's going to be the biggest differentiator in that? Will it be price or something else?
No, I think it's really the customer experience. It's all about, really providing an easy-to-use experience where you're making fast decisioning. Ultimately, you want to become the trusted advisor for your customer, because there's tons of competition in banking. Big tech is coming in. The money centers have their mojo back. But if we can ultimately have a great relationship with customers and be their trusted advisor, it's going to be hard to disintermediate us from our customers.
So an unfair question, because I'm going to give you one word.
Okay.
What's the biggest risk to your business right now?
Two, recession or cybersecurity threats.